which is
a segment of the population that most of you probably don't even know exists. In our school system, there's 180 or so kids that are juniors or seniors in high school that when the bell rings at 3 o'clock, they don't go home. They don't have a family. They are on their own, and they have the motivation to get to school again the next day after sleeping in a truck or seeing if they can beg a space on a friend's sofa. We have a few programs in the county that address a small segment of this population, but Hope Place will have 32 beds there, and I think this is a part of the population that all of us can agree on. We have to do something about it. And if I
don't, sure.
Yes. I saw her. She's standing up somewhere. We should clap for her because she helped put it all together.
You know, can I just speak to that for a second, just as the editor of the paper? And I sat in on some of the meetings during the discussions about how to take Hearst Elementary, an empty school, and turn it into Hope Place. And what I came away from with that is that during those discussions, which I was just kind of a fly on the wall at them, but there was a real energy toward people working together to work through what were myriad details that needed to be figured out. Funding, transfer of property, all of these kinds of issues. But by the end of it, it was figured out and a plan could go forward that I think most people who look at that plan would say, this is a viable idea that's going to help homeless children and families, which I think is easier to solve than the adult homeless issue. But still, it came out and it was viable, all of which cuts to the heart of why can't the city and the county and all the other people get together and put the same sort of positive energy towards solving the other part of the homeless problem?
It's the same situation. That's a county to county, school board county to county. It's a funding, the issue we're having with the localized homelessness problems is a funding issue. When we had Hope Place, it was the county dealing with another countywide entity that made it's easier to deal with. So I think the conflict simply becomes, you have all these 16 cities, sure, if there was county support, I would support the county running it, but there's not county council support to do it. So that's the issue. It continues to be the funding issue. And the fights that happen in this community, you just read about them every day. A lot of times has to do with funding. I mean, it really does. So I personally think the reason Hope Place worked, we have great partners with Home. Mrs. Haney did an excellent job putting it together. It made sense. But it was funding was simplified because it was equal partners. I mean, their county or county, just a different name tag.
Sure.
That's why I think we're having issues with Safe Harbor and the other ones versus.
Another reason why you can't use empty buildings is they're really not suited for that purpose. It greatly drives up the operational cost if you have many different campuses. And one of the main reasons why the site was chosen for Volusia State Harbor was because it's adjacent to, it's in the central part of the county, first of all, centrally located, and it also is adjacent to Stuart Marchman, that has the only mental health crisis stabilization unit in our county. It's nearby sources of funding that are sources of services that would have to be duplicated at all these other different locations. So it would greatly drive up operational costs and further exacerbate this discussion of food base ongoing expenses.
A number of readers also brought up this issue as a question. Why not, given that it receives very little use from the public, why not take Manatee Island and make that at least temporarily a place to come?
Again, it gets back to who's going to fund it, who's going to provide the services. You're basically opening it back up to be a tent city. And when we had Manatee Island open, there were existing problems down there. The property, there were existing problems, and we had to close it. I want to go on record as saying there continue to be public restrooms open in the city throughout the day. And to close one park, and even if we close City Island restrooms, there are numerous other public restrooms open throughout the city. So that's a real misnomer. But what you're basically saying is you're going to, I guess what I'm going to go back to is I don't support 10 cities. I basically think they do not work. And again, what you, if the intent is to move people out of homelessness, then you don't do that. What I'm hearing, I guess, somewhat out there is that it's okay to remain homeless and that's a choice and that we need to accept that and that be a responsibility for the city of Daytona Beach to pay for. And because that's what I'm hearing, because that's exactly what would happen is the city of Daytona Beach tax dollars would be on the hook for everything associated with that. The liability, the safety, the maintenance of the property, the policing, and the crime. And I'm not willing to have the taxpayers in this city do that. Again, I'm willing to go get that.
From my perspective, it's really a justice situation and the rights of these individuals that are on the streets. And we need to give them a safe place. They don't ask for much. They just want a safe place to be right now. And those parks and open restrooms that were there worked pretty well, and those people would be happy to stay there until the doors of Safe Harbor open. And we are so close to making that happen. I also don't really understand why we can't just go to the way things were before this crisis formed over the last 2 months. If the pipes got ripped out of the bathrooms, we don't really know who did it. Maybe it was someone looking to scrap the metal. Maybe it was the homeless. If that's part of the cost of keeping them in a situation where they can at least exist in a safe area, where they're somewhat out of sight, where they don't bother the merchants as much, then I think that's a tenable solution. I also want to speak and the PAM's ideas, and I think we need both. Yesterday at the Bridge of Hope, with the Hot Meal Program, where we feed homeless individuals every day, we served 240 people lunch.
And it's good, I ate there today.
All right. So, 40 or 50 beds at the Salvation Army Gymnasium may take care of the crowd that's in front of the county building today, but it's really not taking care of the need that's right here in Daytona Beach. That problem is here today. And I think both of those places need to be open to address this population, or something like a park where they can just go and be safe and be left alone until we get this wonderful shelter project done.
I have to ask a follow-up question there, because I've been through Man on the Island Park. I'm a bike with Chief Chitlett, actually, a few months back. And what it seemed like at the time was that the only people who were using that park were people who were homeless. So, I had to wonder to myself how many people who aren't homeless, people who might use that park, citizens whose taxes pay for that park, how many of them would feel comfortable going to that park? I just wonder how many people went to that park or didn't go because they knew that it had become a place for the homeless.
Well, I can just tell you it's a problem that's been stated to us as well, and I think it's a balance. What I'm hearing, if I'm hearing correctly, is that basically the city of Daytona Beach taxpayers should deal with this problem and pay for it. That's what I'm hearing, because that is who will have to assume the cost. And I will tell you that is part of the problem with any proposal. The mindset in this county has been it's a city of Daytona Beach problem, and it's not, and there are homeless throughout the county. We also been told over the years by different people, some I've been told directly by individuals who I know were telling me the truth, that other municipalities have brought their homeless to the city of Daytona Beach and dropped them off our city leaders. Okay? So what has happened is we are being forced to pay for and deal with the problem that other communities would just as soon ignore. And I can tell you that the people that live in my city have had enough of that. And they
didn't have a problem with it when they would give them bus tickets.
I think that I hear so much conflict between cities, between city and county, and that's just really, really sad. Because it's just, we need to get it together. And although, Josh, I really do like the ultimatum in a sense, because it's bringing stuff ahead, it just seems as though it'd be more cooperative and mature to say, hey, let's do something, let's work together, let's make this happen now.
Yeah. So, if Kumbaya Day is no, we've said we're going to pay $4 million how long ago? They closed Manatee Island and they complained that, oh, our money's being wasted, when Manatee Island was built on CRA dollars, which we contribute as a county. All of us, $2.1 million last year, which, by the way, as I was sitting, because part of, I guess, the issue with what I was doing last night, I also get bored really easy. I'm sitting at the river going, what am I going to do for the next 20 hours? I'm looking at Manatee Island fully lit up, and I'm like, huh, this makes a lot of sense. I'm looking at a banjo minnow, Manatee Island, just as I'm sitting there freezing my off. And it's lit up, all the lights on Manatee Island, and it's all locked. So, and I'm thinking, who's paying the electric bill? The CRA. Who's paying all right. The CRA? We are. So, somebody has to get in. We have to get to a point, and I'm sorry I pissed off some of my friends. I love them. I love the city commission at Daytona Beach. I sent them an email right after because I'm thinking, this is going to be hard. Someone's got to write a check. The CRAs can easily write that check. We've committed to writing a $4 million check. Let's get it done right now.
Well, I think we need to work together to get it done, but I'd like to continue by saying that if we're looking for a place that can be a compromise kind of situation, I think since Volusia Safe Harbor is going to be a go-ahead, I think, and that needs to be our constant focus to make that happen, I think the land out by Volusia Safe Harbor would be a place that we can make a safe zone where people can sleep and stay.
I want to, we've got about 10 more minutes before I turn it over to the audience for questions, and I want to get there. And let me just say, first of all, you guys are like herding cats. You completely destroyed my my script, but that's fine. I want to get this question on the table because it came from several readers, and perhaps, Josh, this is the test whether you're truly sleep deprived or not. But to you and to the others, should Volusia County consider a tax to fund Safe Harbor or other programs for the homeless?
A sales tax? I know they're trying to get the beverage tax. This is how easy I am. Whatever the city of Daytona Beach can get the support of the cities to do to get it done, I'm going to support. I don't. You can tax me more. I don't care. I'm in. Yeah, the county stepped up. We have a $4 million. Whatever the city of Daytona Beach can get done, all I ask is this, and this is it. Part of this ultimatum, if you will, is not to say the city of Daytona Beach has to pay for it. It's just like Sunrail. When I got on the county council, the contracts were already done. We had to do a couple final signatures. The county did not have a direct revenue stream to pay for Sunrail. They didn't. So what they had to do at the time was to guarantee it with their general fund, which is how we pay for it. If we can find a direct revenue source, we'll switch to that to eventually pay for Sunrail. But I think to get this done, all Daytona would have to do is just guarantee it. I'm not saying they have to pay for it. I'll help them champion. I'll go to Tallahassee with them to try to get something done to find a revenue source. But to get a shovel in the ground and get it started, all they would have to do is guarantee it. It'd be a similar contract like Sunrail, and I can tell you, we already have our attorney working on it if Daytona wanted to go that route, which I really, really hope they should consider.
To anybody else, is there an appetite out there for a tax, a county in the county, in the various cities, in Daytona Beach? And is there the sense of support for that to help pay for?
We're not pursuing a county tax. What is being pursued is what has been going on in Miami for years. And it exists right now, and all we're asking them to do, we're asking CUCL to move it forward, is to allow that legislation to be available to other counties. It has to be put locally on a referendum, so you still have to vote on it locally. It's really just an enabling legislation, and it would be a food and beverage tax. So it's only on businesses, it's not hotels, motels, it's restaurants of a certain size, over 400,000. That is what we're pursuing, because the reality is of this, is that we can get the money to get it up and running the first year is the sustainability. And that's the concern that's been expressed by other mayors that I've talked to within the county, is what happens 5 years from now, even if they commit X amount of dollars. So the critical piece of that is the sustainability. And we truly believe there needs to be a dedicated source on that. So that's where we are with the operating funds.
And just with what she said, I think we as citizens here need to, can we write to Dorothy Kugel and let her know? And I think, it's a great, we actually came up with this idea 4 years ago about this, what Miami does, and do this surcharge kind of thing, and finally, we're moving along with that simultaneously, but we citizens can make a difference, and we citizens can write to Dorothy Kugel and let her know that we want, and it's not too late to do that for this session. Because it's changing the law, it's not really creating a new law. So it's just broadening it so all the counties in Florida can use it. So if you want to do something, write to Dorothy Kugel, email Dorothy Kugel, call her, let her know the citizens want this.
Okay.
Yeah, I want to make a comment about this. And, you know, Father, faith group, individual faith churches, churches in the community and the county are certainly willing to step up to help fund it. But the one other piece that we talked about yesterday, and I know everybody wants something to happen now. That's what we talked about, too, is we have people saying we want to give and we want to help. And we talked about a lot of different agencies. And because people have strong feelings about different agencies and organizations in this community, one way or another, the city of Daytona Beach agreed to be, if people want to donate now to help those people on Beach Street to get them permanent housing, if they want to give now to Safe Harbor, if they want to give now to Hope Place, the city of Daytona Beach is setting up a portal online and by City Hall in which funds that anyone in this community wants to give will be put aside in a special pot of money that will go to the homeless in this area. And we make that decision just
today. I want to I have one more question and then I want to get to audience. So I wanted to say that for the people who are going to be handling our microphones, if they want to get up to their microphone stations. All right. This is directed, I guess, to Father Phil, but to everybody, because you're a member of the clergy. And this question actually came from a lot of readers. And I'm not going to name them all, because I think people are uncomfortable criticizing churches. But so let me ask on behalf of all of them. And it was sort of, this is the question. It seems that our local churches could and should do more. This can't totally fall on the taxpayers. Why are most of the hundreds of churches in Volusia County, why aren't they providing sanctuary for the homeless?
Okay, great question. First of all of my members of my church are taxpayers. And they are doing a lot as far as that goes. And so we are all pretty much, as far as I know, I may have maybe one or two parishioners can laugh at that, who are taxpayers, but my parishioners are pretty much all taxpayers and pay pretty good taxes and are doing their part. I also do know that many churches do a tremendous amount presently. We help out with home, we have a food pantry. I know that Our Lady of Hope, Father Chris Hoffman says his church gives over $100,000 a year to help the poor and homeless in our community. So I don't know what church this person goes to, but our churches are doing a tremendous amount. In addition, it's always nice to say, well, somebody else should do it, or I always want to meet somebody, because somebody has a lot of jobs in my church, too. So somebody should do a lot of things, but the church people are doing their part, and also they are very generous, and they are continuing to be generous, because as just in one day I called, first of all, we cannot house people in our churches, so that's just...
Explain why that is.
Well, first of all, I have a school. Unless you're fingerprinted, you're not coming near my church, especially during the night. But also there's liability issues, there's safety issues, there's zoning issues, there's tremendous amount of residential.
I think that's the issue that I've heard, is that there are simply zoning issues that prevent churches from providing sanctuary.
Yes, there are a lot of zoning issues to provide sanctuary for people to sleep the night there. So we're not residences, we're places of worship. Then we get variances on that, I guess, for cold shelter nights that we are able to do that.
Yes, in an emergency situation.
Sure. But so that is part of the reality. But I trust me, churches are doing it. And as I said, when I've asked churches to respond, actually Imam Malal called me and said, they read in the paper that I wanted to get churches to give more money than they're giving already. And Imam Malal called me and says, we want to help, we want to be part of that. So I'm working with him, and I've talked to St. Brendan's, and I talked to Westminster Presbyterian Church, First Presbyterian Church, and Our Lady of Hope, and Epiphany, and just those five calls or six calls that I've made. Master's Domain also wants to be part, so people are willing to be part. I spoke to our Sikh brother there, Kripal. He said, we're part, we're going to do something. So in addition to what we're doing, churches are stepping up and will step up, and we do want our skin in the game, but obviously none of us can do this without what the county is doing and what hopefully all our cities are doing, because this is a county problem, county-wide problem, and it is a human problem, and we are all connected and all must participate.
Okay. I just quickly want to add, Halifax Urban Ministries is faith-based, and the churches in our community supplied us with over $300,000 last year. We receive very little grant funding, contrary to what most people believe. About 15% of our budget is through grants. The church is the single largest donor to the work we do, which is to shelter those 100 families, to feed 250 people every day, to deliver houses to the families.
Heidi, welcome.
Yes, and piggybacking on that, in Deltona, we have 13 churches that provide services for people. There are 13 churches in our city, and they provide, on alternating days, dinners. They provide support services. We have the Community Life Center that is now up and running again. It's very much faith-based and has been in the past, that is really working with tracking people and providing services and aid for electric bills and gas and so forth. Those, our faith-based community in my city is amazing. And they do a lot of work quietly. They do a lot for those people in need. It's not broadcast. And again, we don't have the visual problem that you have here in Daytona that everyone is talking about this evening, but we have a community that definitely needs assistance and it needs help. So my place here is not to say that there is no homeless problem or no problem in Daytona. There is a definite problem of people that need support services and they need help. And we support, the city supports through CDBG money. We support the Community Life Center. We support New Hope Baptist Church. We support the Neighborhood Center of West Volusia. We support a lot of agencies. And I think that if things, if Safe Harbor comes back with a different outline, I can speak for myself, I can't speak for my commission, but I can speak for myself that I would absolutely revisit it and look to see, to be a part of it, because it shouldn't be an east-west divide and it shouldn't be certain cities that don't want to participate. We all have to, and if that means restructuring a funding source, and I know we can't use HUD dollars for the shelter, but we can use HUD dollars for other supportive services that maybe our money is going to that we can redirect for a shelter. There are ways to do that. Every city has to be at the table. We have to have an understanding from our staff. As an elected official, I don't know everything. I rely on those people that are experts in that field, whether it's the people that deal with HUD, the faith-based community, other entities, and the judicial system to explain and interpret everything that we as elected officials need to do, and we do all need to come together. We're never going to solve the problem, because it's not only a human problem, which is for me up foremost, it's an economic problem. What you have in this area is definitely affecting your economic development, and if that affects you here in Daytona, it affects the entire county, it affects the tax base, it affects what we can do as all the cities and how we can make our area better. So it is all our problem.
Okay. Thank you. I want to get to audience questions and comments, and I thought I would start, if it would be okay with him, with Tom from Rocco's. Tom's right back there, Corey. And for everybody who has a question or a comment, what I'd like you to do, if you could, is state your name. If you're a business owner, state your business and identify yourself, because we do have a reporter covering the meeting. Just give it a try, Corey, and see if it works.
I don't know if it's on, is it?
Yep.
Yes, Tom Myers, Rocco's Frozen Yogurt.
across the street. I'm also representing Beach Street Merchants. I'm here because of my concern for the quality of life that we now have in Daytona Beach. Since that was on the fantasy island of the city, now involved in a lawsuit, that just escalated the homeless population. And I'm not talking about the homeless that you guys are discussing tonight, because God bless everybody involved with that. Thank God we've got you to help these people. But the criminal homeless are out of control. There's no rule, there's no laws or anything for those people. And they affect everybody in this room trying to do the good for this cause. My concern right now is, we have people now that I'm having to rescue. Elderly people, senior citizens, young girls are getting trapped in between their cars, panhandle. That's not panhandling. That's accosting somebody. That's assaulting somebody. And that's happening every day. You can't go anywhere. When I say quality of life, I say, I don't want to leave my house anymore sometimes because I know I'm going to get panhandled 5 times. And when somebody starts approaching me in my car, trapping me, I feel like I have a right to do something. So the criminal part of this, I'm beginning to get real confused about. Mr. Ryder, I've got 10,000 hours dealing with the homeless on my street. 10,000. I sit in front of my business, and anything I say or tell you, I can back it up with pictures, any kind of documentation, video that you want. And I'm going to tell you from some of the things that are happening are criminal. They're not homeless criminals, they're criminals. So my question is, when this shelter's built, when we get all this rolling, these criminal homeless are not going to stay at the shelter. They're going to get paid for it. They're going to be back on the streets, they're going to be in our communities, and we're going to have to deal with them. And I think what the community and the taxpayers deserve is something in writing as to what's going to be addressed and done about that, because I am not going to continue living like this. And I don't think the community and the taxpayer public should. So, another thing, Mr. Ryder.
Well, do you want me to answer the question for you? Because you asked the question.
Well, I just have one thing. The county went ahead and allowed this to take place to come here. I worked for AT&T for 27 years. I ran into a lot of situations, a lot of people. And if this would have been my situation, and I would have walked in and told my boss, hey, I took care of the problem, we managed the island, we're just going to let those people stay there. First question my boss would ask, okay, what kind of management? What kind of guidelines do you have over there?
Council, we need you to wrap up.
If I would have said nothing, I would have been fired. So I don't understand why there isn't some kind of regulation or guidelines. Now, why can't you tell those people to go to the back of the building, not be so visible? Because this is absolutely a circus now.
All right. Thanks. First off, you mistake like inaction with action. I'll explain why. I'm a lawyer. Most people in here, a lot of people know I'm a lawyer because I see my commercial a lot more clean cut in it or outside the bus. What I did when I really read the case law and I saw what the city did, the city closed these bathrooms. You can close some bathrooms and it's still going to be part of the court case. You close certain parts of City Island, you close Manatee Island, you do these things. You put the county in a situation where they have to make a decision, hence the inaction. As a lawyer, I know if I kick these people off, if I join in the same type of choke-out technique, this choke-out tactic, which really, you guys should be mad at City Commission, you should be mad at the county for this, because we didn't create that problem. What they did, in essence, is brought us into the lawsuit. As someone who understands the case law, who's someone who is accountable to every single one of you as your county representative, I'm not going to dumb myself down and not be a lawyer. What I, in essence, did is went to the county council and said, let's do nothing for now until we can come up with a viable, quick solution. Why? I don't want to be part of the 8th Amendment lawsuit. I thus shielded the county from any litigation, because once the city is arresting people and taking them to the jail, they have an 8th Amendment problem. You're seeing the people at 250 Beach Street because the city created the problem. They created. I'm not saying they created homelessness. I'm not saying they created homelessness. But it's been here before Pat Rice was here. It's been here since my parents were little kids living right off Beach Street. It's been there. But they squeezed one end of the balloon and brought it to another. What I did with the plan of three, which is a 60-day plan, the third month to the end of the year, and then Safe Harbor, shielded us from litigation, shielded us from the problem. So all I'm trying to do is get us from point A to point B. Sure, the Beach Street merchants are, for some reason, pissed at me for this. I don't understand, since I'm trying to get them off and out of your businesses. I love Peachtree. I go there. I actually go. I'm sorry. I can't eat ice cream. My wife has me on this crazy cleansing. But I do go to all the other restaurants in that area. And I enjoy them. I do. So I don't understand why the county is the big bad wolf here.
All right. I don't know if anybody else wants to address Tom's question up here. And then we'll go to the next person. Mike, I know that you have a question. Corey, if you can get down that way. And if you could get out to the aisle to ask it.
Pastor Mike Pastore, ordained minister and homeless advocate.
Yeah, right.
First of all, I find it curious that a city commissioner has a born-again interest in creating a short-term solution when you've been stonewalling it for a year. It's only because that Josh Wagner has actually stood up and actually did something to get people off the fence. With respect to Manatee Island, it doesn't have to cost the city anything. I have five churches behind me that right now, they say, Pastor Mike, they'll never let you do it. But if they do, we will support you. We'll give you whatever you need. We'll pick up our cots and march down there through the open gates and set up under the pavilions and provide the city with a certificate of insurance with security and supervision, and there won't be the problems that the Beach Street merchants, and just like the Orange Avenue merchants, all right, you throw them under the bus, you close the bathrooms, all right, you close the bathrooms, and you created this issue. And as far as Salvation Army is concerned, I invite you, Josh will take your hand, walk you across the street, and if you can find five people that thinks it's a good idea to go to Salvation Army, I can tell you you're wrong.
Okay.
They ain't going.
All right. Thank you. I want to remind everybody that it's okay to be passionate here. It's an emotional issue, but I want people to be respectful and civil in addressing the panel as well. So with that, Pam, I'll let you weigh in.
I just want to respond to the comment regarding, again, someone dismissing an agency that's a valid agency in this city. It wasn't to go to Salvation Army, Mike, and in the year that you have come and talked to the commission, I've not once heard you talk about getting somebody off the street and linked with services. Mm-hmm. And we've talked repeatedly about trying to get people with services in the city of Daytona Beach. You know, we continue to be told we've done nothing. And we fund in this city a homeless program, the streets team, to try to help people quit being homeless. We've done that for years. We funded and took the lead on the Marvin study, but it continues to be not enough. What you chose not to hear what I said is what the team went out to do, and what our attempt was not to move people in the Salvation Army. It was to assess their situation and link them with services and try to get them in permanent housing. The Salvation Army would only be for those that we are unable to get linked with services and off the streets in the next few weeks. That was never our intent, to move them from one place to another. It is, as I keep saying, to have them no longer be homeless and in stable living environments. That's what we're trying to do.
Thank you.
Do you have somebody with a question?
I want to ask a question.
Doug House, Ormond Beach Alliance Church. And I've been friends with Mark for a while and Father Phil, and I'm really excited to see that we're finally doing something.
I want
to
ask a question about
my church about 6 years ago. Took two homeless guys off the street. Plan. We were about to give them the line, go be warm and be well fed, and we decided that we had to do something different. So we housed. Now, I might have problems zoning, I might have problems with my liability, my insurance company dropped me and I had to pick up another one. But 28 people called my place home. And It might be this. It might be that I'm, if any of you were a teenager and in church and you ever had a church lock-in, I have a 365-day, 24/7 lock-in. And what I found is that obviously none of this change is going to happen until we coordinate services, until we make sure that the people like myself aren't lost in the maze of where to get services, especially mental health services, especially drug addiction services. I mean, I put somebody in detox, 3 days later they're out and they're not getting home doing dope. I mean, it's ridiculous. It doesn't seem to make sense. We've got to coordinate these services and move people with case management from one position to finally be home.
Okay.
Now, I think the thing that I'm hearing, though, is that one group wants to do it now, and the other group says, pump your brakes, we've got to talk about the financial issues. And I think that there is a need. I mean, I at first, when I looked at the Marvin plan, I thought it was way too expensive. I mean, I'd do it for nothing. I mean, I got a paid for building. I got lights, they got to be on a little bit longer, and I got heat. It's okay, it's got to be a little warmer. But I've got 28 people off the streets, including two students that are in school and that they came to my church on Sunday crying that all the shelters were full.
Thank you. And I want to ask Judge Schumer to discuss or kind of lead a discussion back to you about the need for coordinated services, which sounded like kind of a critical issue.
Coordinated services are certainly important, and that's the cornerstone of Volusia St. Barbara. The wonderful work that the churches are currently doing in our community and Salvation Army, that's wonderful work and it's vital, and I certainly salute you all for that. However, under the Pottinger case and in other cities, that really hasn't counted towards the kind of a come-as-you-are shelter that accepts anyone, whether they're intoxicated, whether they're mentally ill, whether they are under active addiction. It doesn't shield municipalities from lawsuits in other areas like Sarasota or Miami or Fort Lauderdale. And that's really the undergirding of a come-as-you-are shelter, like Volusia St. Barbara, and that's really what we need.
It's not a come-as-you-are shelter.
Can't think.
The other piece of that is that countywide plan that I told you coming to the Roundtable of Cities, when we hear Heidi talk about what's going on in Deltona, and the pastor mentioned a missing critical piece is that umbrella coordination of all funding, all services, all shelters, and that's what we're trying to get developed and move forward, because until you look at it globally and have everybody fit it together, we're going to continue to be splintered, and that is what we're trying to finish by next month.
All right, thank you.
Just a little bit to that. I'm on the COC, which I hate all these acronyms, but it's a mandated federal organization at the local level that takes care of all the state and federal dollars. And it's part of a system called the HMIS, which is just a database to track all the dollars and all the people that we serve. And they have just confirmed that they're going to take and hire a full-time coordinated interview person that will oversee bringing all the people with their specific need to the service that provides those. And we are really excited that in the next few months that will finally be implemented. So coordinated entry will be here in months, even before St. Barbara opens.
Corey, do you have something with a question?
Big John. Pat, thanks for letting me speak. You don't return my phone calls, but I appreciate this minute.
You're welcome.
We should, thanks. We should compliment the judge, Mark from Hum, the Most Holy, Prophetville, and Joshua. Joshua is our champion.
Get this going.
So I have one question. Oh, by the way, Mike is from the ACLU. Ken is from the ACLU. Brad's from the ACLU. Debbie's from the ACLU, and I'm from the ACLU.
Are you considering a lawsuit?